because they're gently used. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. How's everybody today? Come on, now what?
Blessed and highly favored.
Amen. You are blessed and highly flavored. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, and thank you. Would you grab your Bibles? Okay. Let's go to the book of Revelation first. Revelation 3. Training for reigning. Grab your manuals and learn today.
Amen.
Amen. Are you here to learn to give? Everything we learn, we should be able to teach. Amen. Everyone say, I'm a teacher.
Of truth.
So I can bring people to the person of truth. Revelation 3 in verse 14. And the angel of the church of the Lord of the Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen. The what? The faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. Speak it with me. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I can wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Wow. That's reality. Man, that alone ought to put fear right in you. It ought to cause us to examine ourselves. Am I cold or am I hot? Where am I? You know why people go from hot to lukewarm or cold? Because they get neutralized. Neutralized. Neutralized is normalization. Neutralization is caused by normalization. And I want to talk more about that today. It's caused by what? Normalization. It's something that the powers of darkness have been doing since the garden. They're trying to cause normalization. They want to exchange everything so that everything becomes and seems normal. Well, that's normal. It's normal to, for now. Look at all the things that are normal now. But they're not. See, God don't change, does he? So it's normal now to have, they might as well just have one bathroom. It's normal. It's normal for abortion. It's normal for fornication. It's normal for lust. See, this is what the world has been implementing. For years, this is what the powers of darkness want to do. See, when the body of Christ, in the beginning of the New Testament, when the body of Christ was rising to its form to be more Christ-like, after multiple years, it became more neutralized. We didn't see as many signs and wonders. We didn't see as many revelations. We didn't see so many things that were going on. But see, things have become normal. The body of Christ, the enemy always tries to neutralize us. In other words, to put up with evil instead of expose it. In Matthew 24. This country was founded on the principles of Christianity. It has been exchanged. It's been taken. It's been stolen. It's being more and more transformed on the principles in the fight for Antichrist from the head of the White House all the way down. They are ushering in the spirit of Antichrist. Does everybody understand that? So they must neutralize Christ, his character, his principles, and his moral aspects. Does everybody understand that? they want to neutralize these things. So they neutralize it by bringing things to a normalization. Slowly, they've been creeping in, slowly moving things out of Christ-like. We've seen prayer being removed out of schools. We've seen the Ten Commandments being removed out of buildings. We've seen anything, you can't say, Christmas is no longer celebrated according to Christ, it's just a holiday. Everything is being normalized, actually neutralized by becoming normal. They're trying to implement it and exchange these things that were highly exalted by Christ and the kingdom of God to become normal, calling the things good that are evil and evil things called good. That exchange has been happening. It's getting worse and worse. What it's caused is people become dull. Dull. No longer sensitive. In Matthew 24, is everybody there? Is everybody okay? In verse 3, would you read it with me? Now, as Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when these things will be and what will be the sign of your what? Coming and the end of the age. Jesus answered and said what? Take what? Take heed. That means how you're going to hear things. Take heed that you do that what? No one what? Deceives you. Satan's greatest weapon is deception and his power is fear. What he wants you to do is live for you. He wants to get you to a place where you're first. One of the great things that moved people out in the arena that neutralized people is the enemy knows how to deal with their emotion. Oh my gosh. He knows how to deal with their emotions. He loves people that are easily offended. Why? Because he can neutralize them. He loves to implement so that a person puts himself first. So he does or she does what he wants to do. Because it felt like I should do it. Compromise. Dangerous. He said in verse 5, for many will what? Come in my name saying, I am a Christian or I am the Christ and will deceive many. He said, you're going to hear of wars and rumors of wars and see that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. Right? But the end is not yet. For nations will rise against nations and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in various places. Is that happening? Man, more than ever. He said, all these things that are beginning of sorrows. We are already in the beginning of sorrows. The beginning of sorrows is associated with releasing, breaking seals in preparation for revelation. We are here and almost done with the beginning of sorrows, entering tribulation next, very soon. Look at the fight. You can tell by the governmental fight. You can tell by what's going on all over. You can tell. There is tension. There is hatred. You have to fight this off. There is perversion. You have to fight this off. There is the love of self, the love of money, all these other things that are love would neutralize individuals because it's caused by a normalization. People are more fighting for how they feel than what the truth is, putting people out of position. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, normalization. That's today's teaching. Today's training, normalization. Everyone say, I'm not normal. Thank God. Amen. You know, it's amazing because when I was an addict and I lived to get high. That's all I did was I lived to get high. And I used to sit in my home that was emptied, and I'd look out the window and I would cry. I wanted to know what it was to be like to be normal again. What was it like to be normal? So I started getting cleaned up, and I still wanted to know what it was like to be normal. There was something in me that, even though, okay, I was clean now, but I still, there was something that says, hey, this is not who you are. Then I had a visitation from the Lord who delivered me, healed me, filled me, and I found out what normal is. Because I was no longer living for me. See, normal in the kingdom of God is totally the opposite of normal in the world. Totally. See, the word says that we're peculiar. Strange to some. Crazy to some others. Religious to some. I mean, we're not religion. We're not religious. The enemy loves religion because it brings people into bondage. There's a freedom. Why? Because religion has to do with regulations, works. How many times a day you pray? It has to do with numbers. Christianity has to do with relationship. When you know that you're a son and a daughter and he's your dad, you've just entered Christ-like kingdom. That's about the kingdom. Doesn't mean we're going to be perfect, but when we make a mistake, we repent quickly. But our first love is him. When anything else is before him, we're distanced, we're disconnected. Remember, the enemy always wants to bring a disconnect. That's his job, and he does it very well. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1, would you read it with me? Now the what? The Spirit expressly says that in the latter times. Are we in the latter times? Some will what? Depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. What is going to happen? They're going to fall from that. There's going to many be drift away because they're going to become neutralized by normalization. What's going to happen? It's causing individuals to depart from sons of God to sons of the devil. Acts chapter 28. Normalization. Acts 28:25, please. It says, so when they did not agree among themselves, they departed after Paul had said one word. He said, the Holy Spirit spoke rightly through Isaiah, the prophet, to our father, saying, go to this people and say, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see, but not what? Perceive. For the hearts of these people have what? Grown dull. They've grown dull. How did their hearts grow dull? Because they got neutralized by normalization. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes have what? Closed. Lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears. Lest they should understand with their hearts and what? Turn, run. Depart from evil, so that I should what? Heal them. How many of y'all know God wants to heal you? First of all, he wants to heal you emotionally. Emotional sickness is the worst. It's worse than having a broken leg. Why? Because emotional sickness has to do with the mind. That's how a person thinks, because as a person thinks, he also has a feeling. people are heavily emotional are dangerous to themselves and others. And it's not because they're bad. It's because they're easily deceived. Does everybody get this? See, we've got to come out of the emotional arena. See, the enemy loves to play on emotions. You know, loves to play on emotions. Everything's emotion. Oh, look at how sweet. There's three emotions. Peace, joy, righteousness, and the Holy Spirit. It's called love of God. That's God's love. There's compassion, yes. But we don't get sucked into the emotional, soulish arena where we allow righteousness to be called evil or evil to be called good. That's soulish. That's soulish. You call what it is, and that's how it is. You compromise it, you open the door to yourself, and you fall in to the emotional state of torment. Does everybody understand this? If you compromise it, you agree with it, you fall into it yourself. And then you become, oh, granola. Nutty and fruity. That's what a granola bar is. Amen? You might as well put it in the freezer until it snaps. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 4. There's a law that says what you sow is what you eat. What you sow is what you reap. What you speak is what you eat. Amen? All glory. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 4. If you're an individual that needs to know everything right now, you're anxious. I need to know it now. Hair stands up everywhere. I need to know now. You know? But if you're a person that's trusting God, you're willing to wait. I might not know it now, but I know it'll come. I don't need to know it now. If it ain't on my table, kick it off. Nothing to do with it until God puts it on the table. What's on your table, you deal with. What's not on your table, don't look for somebody else's. Man, it keeps peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. People are still trying to figure out, calculate. You don't need to. He will bring it to you if you let him. Is everybody okay? Verse 1, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. What's it say? I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will what? They won't endure sound doctrine. Have we hit that yet? Oh my gosh, have we? People are not enduring sound doctrine. You know why? They really don't believe it. Or they don't constantly, look it, if you don't stir yourself up, he will. So you're going to be stirred from above or stirred from beneath. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own what? Desires. Your own desires. How many of y'all know what an emotion is a desire? Amen. If he can play with your emotions, he promotes his own desire, and you think it's yours. Because they have what? Itching ears. They will heap up for themselves what? Teachers. And they will turn their ears away from the truth to be turned aside to fables, which neutralize the character of Christ, and it's neutralized by becoming and accepting normalization according to the world. What the world says is okay. You know, the world promotes selfish fame. You must be somebody. You must get a job, an education. You must have a bank account. You must. You got to have a house. You got to have this. You got to have that. The gotta, and I gotta. I'm telling you, that's all you need is him, and you have everything. Amen. See, people, that's where the people do not labor unto the Lord. They labor unto themselves and don't even realize it. But there are those who think they're laboring unto the Lord, but they're really not. They labor unto the Lord through their mind, but their heart's not there. See, there's a difference in relationship through the heart and through the mind. Fables. It's caused by fables, which is the world's normalization. But we are not of the world. We are not. Everyone said, I'm not of the world. I'm just passing through. I'm eternal. Okay, you ready for the next step? Everyone say, I'm not human. I'm not human. You kidding? They think I'm nuts. I am not human. You're not human. If you're going to stay human, then you're going to fall into the precepts of the world. Humans live for themselves. Humans live for fame. Humans live for success. Everything is before God. That's a humanite. He's associated with the Obamanites. Why? Because they want a handout. Mine. What can you give me and I'll vote for you? What can you give me? And then they promise free phones. Let's give everybody a phone. Praise God, so they can communicate with one another. No, you don't need a job. Forget it. Well, we're just going to lie about putting a bunch of them under anyways. It doesn't matter. Everything is backed by lies. The father of lies, murderer, deceiver, trying to bring down Christ. Remember, to neutralize Christ's character is to disarm us. When we become disarmed, we become taken. Mark 7. In verse 6, normalization. What its purpose is to dull us spiritually. Does everybody get it? It's to dull us spiritually. In verse 6, would you read it with me? And he answered and said to them, what? Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? As it is written, the people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandment of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the traditions of men, which is called human precepts. The washing of pitchers and cups and many other such things you do. And then Jesus said to them, all too well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your traditions, your human precepts. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother. And he who curses father and mother, let him be put to death. But you say, if a man says to his father or mother, whatever profit you might have received from me is corbid, that is a gift to God. Then you no longer let him do anything for his father or his mother. Making the word of God. Everybody speak this with me in verse 13. Making the word of God what? No effect. Through your what? Traditions which you have handed down and many such things you do. Through traditions of men cause neutralization, which because it promotes normalization. In 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. The first sign of neutralization by normalization is excuses. Make excuses for self. 1 John. Oh, glory. Chapter 2, verse 15. What does it say? Verse 15. Do not what? Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the lust of self, it's called pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who what? He who what? Does the will of God abides forever. So what about the person that doesn't do the will of God? He doesn't abide forever. Little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. It says that they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be what? Made manifest, exposed, that none of them were of us. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. Everyone say, I know all things. Everybody in here knows what's right and wrong. Everyone knows what's holy and unholy. Everyone knows what's clean and unclean. Everyone knows what's righteous and unrighteous. But you have the power to choose which one you will serve. Everyone. That's why Jesus said, you have no excuses now. Why? Because you have the Holy Spirit. Amen. There is no excuse. We have the Holy Spirit. It's a matter of choice. It's a matter of what we agree with. It's a matter. Look at how many of y'all know you. What comes to you, you bring on your own self. It says pride goes before a fall. What's that? Lust of the self. Amen. People are misled, deceived. What voice are we going to listen to? The voice of the stranger or the voice of truth? That's our choice. But you won't know the voice of truth if you don't partake of truth. And it's not just partaking when we gather together. It's partaking on your time. What do you do to maintain truth? Well, I go to church 3 times a week. That's not enough. It must be a daily thing. Do you make contact every morning? If you don't make contact with above, you're making contact with beneath. Well, I don't know if I can do it. You can't. Only he can. That's why you invite the Holy Spirit to help. Does everybody get it? When I'm weak, then I'm strong. See, but if you don't know that, if it's only here and it ain't here, it ain't nothing. It's not what you can do for the kingdom. That's not what it's about. Because you do for the kingdom by just being connected to God. Why? Because there are times when you don't have to say anything or do anything. People see the character of Christ in you. The Lord has sent me to places not saying a word. He said, he gave me, one time he gave me a vision. I saw the Holy Spirit walk out on me and begin to minister to the people. And we left together. We came, he went and did what he had to do. We came back and we booked. And I was driving home. One of the guys that was in this meeting waved me. Hey, I need to talk to you. I'm thinking, whoa. Holy Spirit spoke to him, brought him in the car, shared with him about Christ. Didn't know why he needed to talk to me, but he needed to talk to me. Because he didn't want to talk to me. He wanted to talk to the... He was in me. I just yielded my voice. I love to be possessed. Possession is wonderful. As long as you're possessed with light, not darkness. Glory. Hosea chapter 5. I love to tell people to blow them away. Hi, yeah, we start talking, and all of a sudden, yeah, what do you do? Well, I'm a director of a Christian drug program, and I love to get high. What? You know, kind of their eyes open up, and they give me true attention. What? Gotcha now. Okay, here's what it's about. Here's the high. Why? Because I love to get high because I was born, I was created in high. The highest of the most high. And his presence is where I was created. That's where you were created. I was sent into this world where the counterfeit high is. Everything's counterfeit here. Until you get reconnected with home. Then you're able to discern what the true high is and what the counterfeit is. What the true love is and lust. Because see, everything the enemy tries to counterfeit. He has no love. There's no love in the enemy and the powers of darkness and demons at all. It's all pure lust. They have no love in the kingdom, in their kingdom. The only kingdom that has love is the kingdom of God. Other than that, it's no love. It's just fulfillment of self, flesh. Hosea chapter 5. Is everybody there? Okay, I'm getting there. In verse something. Verse 10. Okay. Hosea 5:10. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. The princes of Judah are like those who remove a landmark. I will pour out my wrath on them like water. Ephraim is oppressed and broken in judgment because he willingly walked by what?
Human precepts.
Ooh. What did it do? It neutralized. Why? Because human precepts are normalization. What did it say again? Look at this. It says, Ephraim is oppressed. Hello? And broken in judgment. Because he willingly walked by human precepts, by the emotional arena of humanity. Everyone say, I'm not carnal. I am spirit. Say it again, I'm spirit. I am spirit. I am not human. I am eternal. Therefore, I will be to Ephraim like a moth and to the house of Judah like rottenness. Whoa. Again, when we walk, when we allow the normalization of humanity in this world to dictate who we are, we become neutralized. We become dull-hearted, dull-minded. And the enemy steals the love of God and exchanges it for the lust of the world, where I must become someone because there is no identity in humanity. Everyone say there's no identity in humanity. Humanity is identified with everything it associates with. Christianity only identifies with one person, Christ Jesus. He's my identity. Does everybody get this? Romans 6. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 6, dear goodness, verse 15. Let's speak it together. What then shall we sin? Because we're not under law, but under grace? Certainly not. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey? Hey, wait a minute. Who you present yourselves to obey, you become a slave to. You are that one's what? Slave whom you obey. Whether of sin leading to death or obedience leading to righteousness. But God be thanked that through you were slaves, though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart. From where? The heart. from of the doctrine of to which you were delivered, and having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Now, I speak in human terms. Why? Because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness and of lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness to what? Holiness. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. But what fruit did you have then in the things of which you are now ashamed of? For the end of those things is what? The end of those things is what? Death. He had to speak in human terms to them because they could not receive. Amen? 1 Corinthians 2. Normalization brings neutralization, dullness, and even hardness of heart. Because we fall in a state of rebellion. In verse 1. Well, it's good to hear the pages turning out on a Sunday morning. Training for reigning. Let's speak it. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of what? Human wisdom. Let me share with you. Human wisdom will neutralize. See, humanity's common sense is different. There's an area where there's common sense of human, but there's an area of common sense that's from above. It's called discernment. It allows you to see through the physical to understand what's influencing the physical. If you're not one that's able to understand and discern what's influencing the physical, then you're still under human precepts. Is everybody all right? A couple of you anyways. Verse 4, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of what? Man, human. But in the power of God. In other words, he was able to overcome. He overcame carnality. He was able to overcome unrighteousness. He was able to overcome sin. He was able to overcome the influence of the world. He overcome it by the power of Christ. Overcome carnality, humanity's precepts. And maintain in an area of eternal. Why? He maintained his identity. You know, it always goes back to the foundation of the enemy's trying to steal who you are. Or you never get who you are. You know how many people die and never know who they truly are? They think they know who they are, but they never know who they are. And there's a difference. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy 3. I could be here for days talking about this. It's phenomenal. And there's so much. But we won't, so. Anybody pack a lunch? It's okay, we're getting the food right now. We don't need to pack a lunch, just eat. Verse 10. 2 Timothy 3:10, let's read it together. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, at Laodicea, and Lystra. What persecutions I what? Endured. In other words, he didn't get taken out. He endured them. And out of them all, the Lord what? Delivered me. Why? Because he did not allow human precepts or human wisdom or human common sense to interfere. Yes, and all who what? desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil men and imposters will grow what? Worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. So there's something you got to do. You must continue. Everyone say continue. In the things which have been learned and have been assured of, knowing from who you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. In other words, there's something important we must do. We must be disciplined. One of the fruits of discipline is consistency. Does everybody get it? It's what consistency. Why? Because if you cannot be consistent, you cannot be alert. I want to share with you something because this leads to wisdom. So when you are disciplined and you are consistent, you become alert. Amen? When you become alert, wisdom, discernment imparts, because wisdom releases discernment. Wisdom releases discernment. Now, I'm not talking about worldly wisdom. I'm talking about godly, eternal wisdom. Amen. Why? Because we are eternal. We must constantly walk into the eternal realm. We don't walk in this realm. You may work in... Did you ever see those things where people... there's stuff that's contaminated, and they put the rubber gloves in this big box. They put the rubber gloves, and they're working on it, you know, like this. They got these rubber gloves on. Why? Because they're working in another realm, aren't they? See, that's us. We're working in another realm. Amen? We're working in another realm, but we're not of this realm. So we're covered. I'm coated with glory. See, the world would call it rubber gloves. See, many try to clothe themselves, thinking that they're from another world, but they're the world from beneath, so they wear all of these things. The only thing you see is their eyes. It's false. It's counterfeit. Glory. Oh, how nice. Galatians chapter 2. Normalization. How does the enemy normalize us and bring us dull, spiritually dullness? By media. By music, by movies, by teaching, by false teachers, by TV, by technology, by education. Our education system definitely normalizes people and neutralizes them from Christ. Lust, desires that the world implements. Dress and style. People rather, I want to wear this even though it's whatever, you know. It neutralizes, normalizes. How about laws? That's what the world is. The government's trying to implement laws to neutralize Christ so they can normalize. That's why they approve all of abortion and everything else. Money. Money definitely will do it if you allow it to be your main focus. Is everybody okay? Galatians chapter 2. Is everybody there? Verse 1. Paul said, then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, and I also took Titus with me. And I went up by revelation and communicated to them that the gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to those who are of reputation, lest any means I might run or had run in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was what? Compelled to be what? In other words, to be circumcised. Why? Because the Jews in that period of time, they wanted to take what Christ had done and bring people back under the law of circumcision. To make somebody righteous. Does everybody get it? So they were not going to come under, Paul said, no way, we're not going under normalization again. We're moving forward with Christ. And they tried to compel them. He said, man, none of us were even compelled to do that again because we live with Christ now. It's no longer we that live, but him that lives. Does everybody understand it? See, so the world is going to try to normalize you. If they can normalize you, they can neutralize you. That's where many people think, okay, well, medication's okay. I'm just going to take these psych medications and I'm going to feel better, except for the side effects are suicide. Yeah. So what the heck? You might as well take a knife to your throat. Does everybody get this? See, the world wants to do these things. Oh, have anxiety. Here, take this. Stuff pills down people's mouth. The world doesn't know how to deal with demonic influence. Oh, I'm oppressed. Here, take this. Oh, I just don't feel one. Everything's take. They got the, remember the butterflies on TV, you know. If you can't sleep, here, take two of these, you know, wake up 3 days later. You may not function at work. You may hurt someone and maybe kill yourself, but it's okay. Take. Hallelujah. Romans 8. Are you getting this? We must be aware of this. It's important. Praise God. Romans 8, verse 12. Let's speak it. Therefore, brethren, we are what? Debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. It's normal, human. For if you live according to being a human, according to the flesh, you will what? Die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the flesh, of the body, you will what? Live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are what? Oh, hallelujah. How many of y'all want to be a son and daughter of God? Yeah. It's either one or the other. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by which you cry out what? Abba, Father. That means dad. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children of God, then what? Heirs. You know, some people need to read this over and over till they find out who they really are and stay there. And quit getting allowing the enemy to steal their identity. Everyone say, I'm an heir.
I'm an heir.
Well, man, that's important. That's not something just simple to toss aside. You are an heir. You are an heir of the one that hung on the cross for me and you. We're an heir of everything. We have everything. We lack nothing. It's amazing how people will fight to get when it's all to do to surrender, and it comes. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs. Everyone say, I'm a joint heir with Christ Jesus. Okay, what does it say then? If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be what? Glorified together. Oh, you ready for the next one? Can you handle it? What's verse 18? For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed where? In us. In us. Oh, people compromise, manipulate to get what they want. Lie. Blame. That's normalization. That's humanity's normalization. And they've been neutralized. Oh, I got a lot to go over here, but I'm not going to go through it all. Hallelujah. Okay, let's go to James 3 first. James chapter 3. Verse 13. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of what? Wisdom. Which wisdom? From above. But if you have bitter and envy, self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is what? Earthly, sensual, and demonic. For where there's envy and self-seeking exists, confusion and everything are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Okay, cool. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and we'll close here. I'll skip the other 40 scriptures. Normalization. Man, you ain't normal. Thank God. If I was normal, I'd be like you, dude. Glory. 1 Thessalonians. Is everybody there? Chapter 5, I'm starting at verse 1. All right, let's close it. Let's grow for it. Let's seal it. And let's walk away from normalization. But concerning the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that the day should overtake you as a thief. You are sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be what? Sober, which means alert. But you can't be alert unless you're disciplined and consistent. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love and the helmet of hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath. Hello, he's warning us, isn't he? Do you understand that he's warning us? He's warning us. Don't get neutralized by normalization, because you'll come under my wrath. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you are also doing. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, but be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly, comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. Rejoice always. Hallelujah. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And do what? Don't quench the Holy Spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Prepare your hearts for communion. You may bring your tithes and offerings up and met this word that God, by the Spirit, has given us, be sealed by the blood and grow and bear fruit for your glory. In Jesus' name.